Thank you all for being here. On behalf of the Race and Gender Project, we'd like to thank our guest speakers, as well as all the students that came, as well as faculty who came to this event. We thank you very much. I'd like to first say that the panel's name is Global Issues in Food and Sustainability. We have three great speakers from William Paterson University, and we're going to start today. Each of the speakers will speak for about 15 minutes, and then we will have a Q&A session with students, so I hope you all brought your great questions along with you. So first, let me introduce Jennifer DeNoia. Jennifer DeNoia received her MS in social work from Columbia University in 1997. After completing her training, she held clinical and administrative positions in family services agencies, during which time she became credentialed as a licensed clinical social worker. She earned her PhD in social welfare from Columbia University in 2000 and has since been conducting research under the sponsorship of the National Institutes of Health. Her research is focused on the development and testing of health interventions for minority and undeserved adolescents. Dr. DeNoia teaches courses in research methods, statistics, and social work practice. She is the field coordinator for students enrolled in the social services degree concentration. So let's welcome Jennifer. Thank you very much.
Talking today about is reducing disparities in food access. And one of the core themes in my talk is going to be the idea of a food desert. So can anyone tell me what a food desert is, or what you think a food desert is, or what it sounds like? Yes. That was a stretch and not a hand up, okay? Anyone else? Yeah, in the back?
Isn't that where they don't have, like, any really healthy food, or like anything? Is mostly just like convenience stores or like little, just not healthy farms or anything.
Excellent. Yes, that's where the desert part of that word comes from. It's devoid of something, and you're absolutely right. It's devoid of healthy foods. Different researchers define the term differently, but most commonly it refers to an area without supermarkets or other places where fresh, nutritious food can be accessed. So let me ask, do you think places like this are common in the United States? Yeah. Yes, you do. Very common? Do you know of any offhand that you can think of? Have you seen a food desert?
Okay,
you think in inner city areas? Okay, good. There's actually, the USDA has a food desert locator, which is a searchable web where if you wanted to put in an address or a zip code, you could actually look to see where these areas are. Just some very basic statistics on food deserts. In the United States, 23.5 million people live in low-income areas that are located 1 mile away from a supermarket. There are half as many supermarkets in those areas as there are in wealthy areas. There's more convenience stores, which we know tend to lack healthy items, than there are in middle-income areas. And of course, in rural parts of the country, residents live more than 10 miles from a supermarket. Okay? So clearly, there are some issues in terms of access to foods when you're a resident of these areas, right? So when you hear these healthy eating recommendations, if you're a resident of one of these areas, you might say, how am I to do that when I don't have what I need, the basic access to the essential ingredients to have a healthful diet? Okay? So what I want to do, just to again familiarize you a little bit more with this, is show you a clip about a food desert. And what I want you to do is tell me, after I show you this clip, it's short, what stands out about this food desert, and what are some of the barriers to healthy eating that are very noticeable and obvious when you look at this? This is a clip about a young lady called Leah, and she's talking about South Central Los Angeles, which is a food desert. And so, let's see, hopefully, okay.
My name is Leah. I've been living in South Central Los Angeles since I was about 8.5 or 9, and I'll be 17 in a month. The trip that I'm taking is to a Whole Foods on 3rd Street and Fairfax Avenue. Well, the first bus I take is on 43rd and Crenshaw. I take the 105, And then the second bus is 210, which is on Venice and Fairfax. It's about an hour or two away on the bus. In my community, which is South Central, there's not a lot of healthy food choices. Almost any minority community is more at risk because the less healthier food is cheaper, ironically and sadly. A lot of minorities have either below minimum wage or minimum wage jobs, requiring them to work longer so that they could survive, meaning they have no time to travel and they don't have the money to travel either. So it makes it harder for them, even if they know, it makes it harder for them to go and get those better foods. You see food everywhere, but it's not food you should be eating. It's all fried or unnutritional in some kind of way. Some of the newer buses have TVs on them, and it makes me so angry every time I see it. They have four different McDonald's that if you tell them that you took the bus or you have proof that you took the bus that day, that you could get a Big Mac meal and get a free ice cream or something like that. And it's in Spanish too. I feel like it's targeting to the Latino community. They play it like a couple of stops before you get to that McDonald's or when you're at that McDonald's. And oh my God, it makes me really angry to see that. From my school to my house, you'll pass by three McDonald's, one Jack in the Box, a Burger King, and like a whole bunch of liquor stores. You start off in a community with almost no choices for healthy eating, and then when you get on the second bus and you start riding, it's like the neighborhood looks better, the people there are different, the houses are nicer. You still see some of those choices, but you see less of them and less people in them. I see happier people. I grew up Seventh Day Adventist. Usually goes along with most Seventh Day Adventists is vegetarianism or just eating healthy in general. I used to be a really, really skinny little girl. And then when I stopped eating what my mom was giving me and started sneaking behind her back at school, is when I really started to like get a little heavier.
Okay, I'm gonna stop the clip there. So what stands out for you about this clip, and what are some of the obvious barriers to healthy eating in this environment? Yeah.
Barrier could be the prices of the food. Like you mentioned that
Good.
The cheaper foods are less healthy.
Good, so we saw a lot of fast food places, a lot of places that sell food inexpensively. Good, what else? Yeah.
The fact that the supermarket is an hour and a half, 2 hours away.
Right, did you notice the clock in the beginning? She got on the bus at 1:07. She actually gets to Whole Foods by 3:20 and she had a switch, right? So certainly a transportation and time barrier, right? If you're working more than one job, you might not have the amount of time it takes to actually do the route that she did to get to the food store. Good. Anything else? How about the advertisements on the bus? Did anyone hear her say that some of them have these advertisements where they say if you take the bus, they give you a coupon to get a Big Mac meal at McDonald's or a free ice cream for dessert? So those are marketing and promotional type of things that we see in communities like this that, again, make it very challenging for someone who doesn't have time, is hungry, got this free voucher for a meal, and might be more likely to go for the McDonald's meal instead of the healthier choices, right? Okay. So let me ask, what do you think that we can do to sort of eradicate these food deserts, these communities that have lack of access to healthy food? What are some steps we might take to eliminate them? Yeah.
Put in a Whole Foods.
So bring more supermarkets into the area. Absolutely. Terrific. And how do we do that? What do we need? Yeah.
I thought you would need funding.
You would need funding. You would probably need policy support, right? So you guys are right on track. Excellent. We need some progressive policies that would encourage supermarkets to locate in underserved areas. And part of that money piece might be some incentives for the markets to do that. Yes?
I feel like there would also maybe incentives to want to eat healthier food as well. So maybe farmers markets or something in the summer.
Okay.
Maybe just farmers incentives.
Good. You're talking about something really important there. When we say that we need progressive policies to bring supermarkets and maybe even farmers markets into these underserved areas, we're talking about structural changes, right? We're saying let's modify the food environment to create more opportunities for people to eat healthfully. But you brought up a really important point, which is there's that, but then there's also the idea of changing the beliefs and attitudes of the consumers, right, about what they should eat and what does constitute a healthy diet and what their knowledge of healthful food is, and that is equally important. Very good. Yes?
If the people who own the supermarkets won't put in supermarkets because they know that people can't afford the expensive food, so it's like...
Huh. So what would they have to then do? In addition to going into those areas, they'd have to make what? Pricing modifications?
Either that or job wages increase and the federal, kind of thing. People that buy better foods that are cost more, they have to have a better funded job.
Okay, good. Anyone else? There's a British group of researchers that, as part of the Pennsylvania Fresh Food Financing Initiative, opened a supermarket in a Philadelphia food desert. And they did a study where they compared body mass index, which was used as a measure of weight status, fruit and vegetable intake, and perceptions of food accessibility in this neighborhood where they put this new supermarket with a comparison neighborhood, so in other words, another food desert that was located 3 miles away, and they picked one that was 3 miles away so that there wouldn't be any contamination, meaning that people in the one neighborhood wouldn't travel over to this one and vice versa, so that they would keep the groups, sort of the community, separate and distinct, okay? So now they addressed this structural barrier. They brought this supermarket in, right? So what do you think? Did it work? Did people's fruit and vegetable intake increase? Did their perceptions of food accessibility increase? Did their weight status either maintain or reduce, meaning did they maintain or lose weight, do you think? What do you think with this new supermarket in town? Anyone? Some of you have the handout of the study. You could cheat and look at the abstract. Mm-hmm. What do you think would happen? Would that do it? I mean, if you build it, will they come?
Yes.
So some of you think yes. You said, well, maybe, because just having it doesn't solve the whole equation because there's the issue of the price, right? So if the food is as expensive, let's say, as other venues, what's the incentive? It's very interesting that you bring that point up, because in the literature we read very often that, the benefit of the supermarkets is they offer the greatest variety and the lowest cost of foods. Right? But we have to look at that. If we bring it in, are the prices actually lower? Are they getting stuff at a better value than they would, let's say, from a corner store or a bodega? So that's certainly a piece. The answer to the question is they did not change behavior by bringing this supermarket into this area. The only thing that they changed was perceived access to healthy foods. So it means neighborhood residents perceived that they could get more healthy foods, but their actual behaviors didn't change. They didn't buy more fruits and vegetables, and they didn't maintain or lose weight. So why do you think that is? Yes?
They might not have the actual time. When you go to the supermarket, you have to grocery shop, then you're buying ingredients. So you have to have time to cook and do all that stuff. And they may not even have the time to do any of that.
So definitely time, absolutely, as a barrier. Yes?
I would say that it really depends on mainly what he was talking about, I guess, the socioeconomic status of the community where they build this in.
Okay.
The thing is that people with high socioeconomic status can afford to eat healthier. That's why it seems like people that are richer seem to be thinner and in better shape. for people in low socioeconomic status that can struggle. That's why fast food chains are so popular, because the food is so cheap, but it's unhealthy.
Okay.
The thing is that it depends on the socioeconomic status. If they have low socioeconomic status, like if they can't afford to buy healthier foods, then they're not going to. Just because you added an incentive to a supermarket doesn't mean that you're going to buy it. Because if it's still a high price and it's not part of your list, then you're not going to get it. Because you just count it as another expense.
Good. So it's not enough to bring it there. You have to also assess the issue of the pricing and the affordability of the items that the new supermarket is offering. Right? That's what you're saying. Good. What else? Anyone else? Yes.
Maybe they were just used to the life that they were living before the supermarket.
Very good. In fact, that's what the researchers of this study said, that there's more about a culture of food and eating than just bringing a supermarket in addresses. And so improving access is part of the equation, but it's not the whole solution. There are reasons that people shop at certain places that are beyond rational decisions. So one of the things these authors reported was that when they looked at interview data, they found that people tend to have routine places where they shop and that they're familiar with. So even though there's this new market in town, if I'm used to going down here and getting my apples here, and then I go over to here and I get my salad and my greens over there, part of that is a big piece of the puzzle. In one of their studies, they had a participant that lived next door to a brand new supermarket, but she still traveled to an area over 3 miles away because that was where she was born, that was where she grew up. She had a connection to that place, and so it was part of a patterned a way of doing things. Supermarkets might not always sell cheaper food, which you all have said, so that was spot on, so thank you for that. Supermarkets also can overwhelm the senses, right? There's so many more choices that can tempt some families to overspend on foods that may be not more healthy, and they might not conserve money to buy the healthier foods. So some of it, again, goes back to what we were saying about nutrition education. We need those nutrition education programs to teach things like food shopping and preparation skills. And also we need to look at in-store incentives, so in-store marketing to promote healthy food purchases, or possibly vouchers or coupons or some type of things that make healthy foods more desirable and part of the things that people will be more likely to put in their baskets when they are shopping at these markets. Okay. Does anyone have any other comments on what we looked at today? Rosa, I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
We've got
That's an excellent, and I want to just say that the students are spectacular. You all are asking really solidly intelligent questions, so thank you very much for participating. Right now, I'd like to introduce our second speaker. David Gilley. David Gilley received his PhD from Cornell University in 2003 and worked as a researcher for the USDA Agricultural Research Service before coming to William Paterson University as a faculty member in the biology department. His research specialty is the behavior of honeybees, the most globally important agricultural pollinator, with which he's been working on since 1996. His current project concerns the functioning of pheromone produced by forager bees as part of their complex foraging recruitment communication system, which has potential applications in sustainable agriculture. Let's welcome Dr. Gilley.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's see here, let me maximize this. I think my approach is going to be to just kind of move through this as fast as I can and present you with the information, and then we'll go back and talk about it afterwards if I have time at the end of my section. Otherwise, please scribble down your questions and we can work on them within the panel format here. So I've worked for the USDA. I'm also currently working on research grants to get funds for working with honeybees with respect to agriculture. And this is one of the issues that we're always dealing with here is the issue of sustainability. In every grant proposal that I write, and everything that I did for the USDA as part of the Agriculture Research Service, so that's the research wing of the USDA, we always talk about sustainability and sustainable agriculture. But what does it really mean? I felt like this is a good place to start. So I do want to talk mostly about bees, but if you'll stick with me for just a minute here, I want to generalize for just a second and think about what is the basis for this? Why am I, a honeybee behavior researcher, always talking about sustainability? And what it comes down to is a law passed in 1990, the 1990 Farm Bill passed by Congress here, is I think one of the, I'm not an expert on this, but this is the first time that it enters into USDA language as far as I'm aware of. And the Farm Bill, don't expect you to read all this necessarily, but I just want to point out that it breaks down into at least three major categories. We've got sustainable agriculture needs to satisfy human food and fiber needs, so this is kind of a nutritional science point of view. It also needs to maintain the natural resource base and not destroy environmental quality, so this is kind of environmental science and natural resource management is in there as part of this law. But then also, on the last two points, we've got, of course, economic, sociological, and legal aspects of this. So we talk about sustainable economically and sustainable sociologically. So it's all wrapped up into one. This is translated more or less directly into USDA policy, and here my sort of quoted example here is from a 1996 memorandum from the Secretary of Agriculture, where he kind of listed these three things. So USDA is committed to working towards economic, environmental, and social sustainability. So, and this has been, I grabbed this picture off the web here, I don't know if you can read this, but it's this stool with three legs, which are the economic, environmental, and social sustainability. This is what we together call sustainability, and in particular in this context, sustainable agriculture. And the bottom part of that is just the rest of the statement saying that the USDA is going to balance all of these goals together, which is a pretty complex thing to do, but to try to come up with policies that balance economic, environmental, and social sustainability. So there's kind of a basic introduction to some of sustainability from my point of view. Let me play devil's advocate for just a second here and talk about what is the alternative that we're talking about. We, in science, we're always double-checking ourselves to make sure that what we're talking about is something that does have an alternative, an alternative hypothesis. Maybe we're too over aware of this, but you know, what exactly is the alternative hypothesis that's in front of us here? Is there anybody out there, for example, advocating unsustainable agriculture? What do we really mean? Is it an empty term? This is something we're always afraid of as scientists. If there's no alternative, is it empty? Does it really not mean much? On speculating, thinking about this, and this is my own personal thinking about this. I don't mean to represent the USDA or scientists here. But it seemed to me that I think the answer is no. I don't think it is a hollow term. I think, though, that it's based historically, and again from an agricultural point of view, on at least two major revelations in our thinking over the last, you know, a couple decades here, thinking of the, you know, 1990, 1996 framework that I put up there before, which is, first of all, that these things are really intertwined and difficult to disentangle, I think, to a greater degree than we've ever realized before. The scientific, economic, and social aspects of this are really, you cannot disentangle these from a policy point of view. To promote sustainability, you can't ignore one of those or two of them and focus on one. You've got to think about all together. So here's another analogy, if you like this better than the stool, gears, whatever analogy you want to go with. So I think we're learning more and more that that's really true, and it's being acknowledged. Secondly, and this is getting into this agriculture part of it, is that we just, again, there's gathering evidence that things that we thought were solutions, short-term solutions, they worked in the short term often, but they're causing long-term problems. And I've just listed a few up here. And some of these are really old. We've known about them for a long time. Clearing of land, irrigation, fertilizers, pesticides, controlled breeding, non-native organism introduction. I've listed in parentheses some of the problems that these cause. There are probably others, I'm sure. So it kind of seems like, it feels like from that list, like we just can't get anything right. but this is a big, I think this is another big revelation here that we're seeing that, boys, more and more the evidence just keeps accumulating and accumulating that these things have long-term consequences. So getting into bees specifically and thinking of bees, bees are related to some of these issues, some of those agricultural problems that I put up there. So let me move into that here by first making the point that bees are really important in global agriculture, especially for the part of agriculture that we would call pollinated crop agriculture, plants that need to that need to exchange pollen to produce fruits and their vegetable products. So here are some statistics up here. You know, you've probably heard this one before, perhaps of about one out of every three bites of agricultural product is comes directly from the pollination services provided by honeybees. You can see some figures for how much, you know, the total value to the world economy. There's a picture here that's showing what breakfast, for example, would look like without honeybees there on the right, with honeybees on the left. The one thing that I want to point to, in addition to, there's some obvious things like fruits and things like that, orchard crops, nuts, all that kind of stuff. But also one of the big ones that you kind of, they put a little too subtly, I think, in here is the coffee, the half and half in the coffee. This represents a huge class of things that have to do with livestock. So a lot of forage crops for livestock, things like alfalfa and clover, are also pollinated by honeybees. We tend to not think about that because we're not eating it directly, but the things that we eat, unless you're vegetarian, are directly dependent on it. So that's actually a huge one in there too. And here's just a list of a lot of some of the common, very common pollinated crops that just shows you how much honeybees are important in those. Now, why do we use honeybees so universally in agriculture, pollinated crop agriculture? We do so for a list of reasons I put up here. They're great. They're what we call generalist pollinators. So they fly. They'll work in an apple orchard just as well as an almond orchard, for example. So you can move them around to any crop. They have a very specialized anatomy for foraging. They are herbivores that explicitly, their only nutritional source is pollen and nectar from flowers. They're also very constant. So each single forager bee will visit only a single species on one foraging trip. What that means is that you get a lot of pollination. If bees are moving from species A to species B, there's no pollination occurring there because you can't reproduce between species. So that's important, and not all bees are like that. Another thing that's really important that not all bees share is that honeybees are in very large colonies. 50,000 individual workers is a typical size for a honeybee colony. That's a lot of little pollinators for one colony in a small area. Furthermore, honeybee colonies are quite robust and transportable. And I'll show you that. Well, you can sort of see the equipment down there on the bottom. That's one of my students out in field here in Haledon. So we have this standardized hive equipment here that we can sort of wrap them all up and put them on a truck and bring them wherever we want to do pollination. There is no other bee that has all these characteristics. So here's how pollination works, very briefly. I don't know if you can see this down here, but this is a giant flatbed truck filled with, I don't know how many hundreds of honeybee colonies. You know, 500 times 50,000, that's how many worker bees you got on that truck. And they truck them all over the United States. Here's a picture of the commercial trucking route. So what they do is they track the blooms of the flowers from place to place. As species one comes up and blooms, they get the bees in there, they pollinate for a couple weeks. That crop, you know, stops blooming. They move on to the next one, to the next. Okay, so honeybees are part of what makes large-scale agriculture possible. I think that's a fair statement. No other bee is as dense and movable. You certainly can get pollination of agricultural crops, but the percentage of pollination is going to be so low that the output, the crop product, will not be enough dense enough to feed the large human population that we're trying to feed. Okay, honeybees are threatened. And this is just a brief history. I'm not going to go into too much detail on it, but I just want you to get a sense of the overall pattern here of what is threatening the sustainability of this system of honeybees involved in agriculture. It goes way back to some things that we don't even kind of know the origin of. More recently, you can see that the pace of these things, I've listed the years for those things that we have a date in the scientific literature that we first see it. And you can see that the pace of these things is picking up. And this is going to lead to a major point that I want to try to make here. Also notice that these are pathogens and parasites. They're mites, they're bacteria, they're fungi, viruses, that kind of thing. This is the dominant problem. If you're a beekeeper trying to keep your bees alive, the major problem is pathogens and parasites, other biological organisms that kill your colonies or really make them weak. Most recently, we've had this issue with colony collapse disorder. Have you guys heard of, is this something that's on your radar? Everybody aware of colony collapse disorder? It's been big in the news because we've seen numbers of colonies drastically drop. Beekeepers go out to their colonies, they pop them open, and instead of looking like this, they look like this. I don't know if you can see that, but basically the comb is empty. And so this has been a major thing recently. Where are the bees going? They're disappearing. Where are they going? Well, I do not expect you at all to read this. So, sorry for the boring slide. But the basic point is that there is an extensive scientific peer-reviewed literature on what's happening with honeybees. And this is just a representative sample of peer-reviewed papers. The basic gist of this, if you were to read through these titles, again, I don't expect you to do so, the basic gist is, look at these recent, 2004, we've got things coming up, varroa mites, Nosema, acute Israeli bee paralysis virus. These are things that are recent arrivals, recent problems in honeybees. This academic discussion has mostly been about which of these parasites and pathogens might be responsible for this. The general conclusion of the scientific, of scientists, is that it has to do with parasites and pathogens, probably exacerbated by things like pesticides, things like nutritional deficiencies that come from large monocultures, that kind of thing. But mostly, as far as a causal factor, it seems to be parasites and pathogens. However, this is not what we're getting in the popular press. Recently, I don't know if you saw this article here in Time, but this was a famous, this was out in August of 2013, I think. And the basic conclusion of this was that was at the top of the line was pesticides, 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 pesticides. This is not very much in the scientific literature, which is interesting. Why is that? They do talk about biological threats some and these sort of exacerbating factors like modern farming practices. But largely the popular press's accounts either go towards pesticides or we talk about here's a quote from a sustainability organization website where it says, besides making a terrible pun, I hate these bee puns, they say we're still no closer to a solution than we were in 2006, which is extremely frustrating from the point of view of a scientist because we've been working on this and we are a lot closer, actually. We've learned a whole lot about this thing. Why is it that they're still saying that we haven't made any progress? There seems to be a mismatch here, and this is I want to maybe talk about this if we have time. But overall, this is my last slide here, to think about whether, so this colony collapse disorder, the most recent problem with honeybees, is this a symptom of an unsustainable agricultural food system? If you simplify, to back up just for a second again briefly, simplify the definition of sustainability to something like the definition I put up here in bold. I kind of like this as a in a nutshell. Sustainable farming systems are capable of maintaining their productivity and usefulness to society indefinitely. So is the use of bees sustainably like that? Is it in danger from things like colony collapse disorder? And I would say yes, it is. I think this is a serious issue. I think the evidence suggests that the sustainability of the bee agricultural system is in danger. But what I guess I would encourage here is that we need to focus on the underlying causes of this. Things like what's causing the transport of these parasites and pathogens, which is global transport. Things are moved all over the place in the world these days, so globalization in general. This is why we have so many, why the pace of parasites and pathogens is increasing faster and faster and faster, because things are getting moved all over the world. They used to stay where they arose. Also, rapid evolution of parasites and pathogens. This is a evolutionary question. They've got short generation time, et cetera. They can evolve past our defenses very quickly. Also, just our scientific infrastructure is aimed more at a solution after the problem arises. We scramble to try to come up with a solution to it, versus a kind of prophylactic, having an established scientific infrastructure that is trying to predict problems and prevent them before they ever become problems. And lastly, just the basic pressure of growing demand, population demands, which is increasing more and more and more. It's demanding more and more and more of the bees. It's stressing the bees out, I guess you might say, and the beekeepers too. So I want to encourage thinking of those underlying threats as opposed to oversimplifying the issue of sustainability. I think what's going on in some of these cases here, and what leads to conclusions like this, which are not, I think, for the benefit of progress and sustainability. I think conclusions that ignore scientific evidence retard progress towards sustainability. I would say that, again, as a scientist. And so I think we have to be careful that we don't oversimplify the concept and say, and let's say, for example, narrow it to pesticides, that sustainability equals, you know, not using pesticides. Because I think in that case, we're going to overlook the true causes of something like this, of colony collapse disorder, that can really lead to agricultural problems. And again, going back to maybe the little gears analogy, if we have problems, if we misinterpret the causes, then we'll get the solutions wrong, and that's going to have effects economically and sociologically that are not, you know, not for the benefit of society. So we got to make sure that we get it right. And I think I'll end there. Thank you.
Thank you, David. I will never look at bees the same way again. I want my coffee. So let me introduce William Kernan. Bill is who likes to be called Bill. Bill Kernan is a social epidemiologist and health educator and is the current chairperson of the Department of Public Health at William Paterson University. Dr. Kernan has considerable experience working internationally on a variety of nutrition and food-based public health initiatives. As a United States Peace Corps volunteer, he developed a comprehensive micronutrient malnutrition prevention program in Malawi, East Africa. He later worked as a nutrition monitoring specialist for the United Nations World Food Program in Guinea, West Africa. He has also conducted food systems and community gardening research in the urban centers of Mexico City and Bangkok, Thailand. His current research focuses on the implications of fasting on Muslim school children during Ramadan and food insecurity among young adults in the United States. Let's welcome Dr. Kernan.
Thank you, everyone. You'll have to excuse my enthusiasm for what I'm about to talk about today, because I don't get the chance to talk about this work very often, and obviously I love it. Today what I'm really going to do is show you my personal photo album from some of my experiences, sort of in a case study format. And I hope, actually, you'll notice many themes running through what I talk about with what our two previous presenters have already talked about. Whenever I first introduce the fact that I'm going to talk about policy, people's eyes gloss over because it doesn't sound so sexy, does it? But in fact, it's really the basis of so much of where we need to go to create a sustainable world where everyone has enough food to eat, and more importantly, or equally as important, the right food. Public health people measure health in lots of different ways. And early in my career, one of the big markers of health that I was interested in was the health of children. Many people say that you can actually measure the health of a community or society by the health of its children. And we know, especially if you look at what's happening globally, that globally, the health of our children isn't so great. You don't need to look far to look at really upsetting statistics about how poorly most of the children in the world are faring, especially very early in life, in the first 6 months, and then in the first 2 to 3 years. We lose large numbers of these children right after birth. In fact, almost half of this pie chart of all the causes of death of children globally are among 6 month old and younger. And the remainder are among children under the age of 5. And what's really interesting to me as a public health person who considers himself a public health nutritionist is that you actually don't see malnutrition in any segment of this pie chart outright. But actually, when you look at most of these causes of death, especially those that represent infectious diseases, malnutrition is always an underlying reason for a young person particularly to develop a disorder of malnutrition, of which we have so many, I can't even fit all the names on a slide, some of which are familiar to you and some of which you may have never heard of before. And in the United States, we're fortunate. We don't see a lot of these. In fact, we tend to see the types of malnutrition that we consider overnutrition, but nonetheless, that's malnutrition. But in many parts of the world, these things are still a part of everyday life, particularly for children. And I would also say, although I'm not focusing on this population today, particularly for pregnant and lactating women as well, another really vulnerable population. So one question I'm going to throw out to you all is this. Do we have enough food in this world to feed everyone? What do you think? Yes? No? Some people are like, just tell us the answer. Well, you know, our gut reaction might be no, because we see instances of starving people all the time. In fact, I could name 5 countries right now that are in the midst of some sort of internal conflict where even 2 years ago, this was a flourishing society where food access and food security were no longer issues, and today they are. But in fact, according to the World Food Program, the agency that I worked for a very long time, we have way more than enough food to feed everyone. So we have to think about, why is this the case? Why do 1 in 7 people go hungry? And why is 1 in every 3 children malnourished? If we have enough food, what's the problem? And while I'm not going to completely answer the question today, I want to talk about, as you heard in the introduction, I've worked in a number of different places across the globe, some successful programs, some unsuccessful programs, and that's where the idea of sustainability comes in. But I'm going to focus on 2 today, both the experiences that I had in Africa. And they each tell a different story. And the first story is one of the obvious, which is part of the global food problem and part of the childhood nutrition problem comes right down to the basic science of nutrition. What happens once the food gets into someone's body? It's not enough, it's not the correct food. So that's part of the story, and that's one of the case studies I want to talk about. But the other part of the story, which is the one that, at least historically, we haven't talked about quite as much, at least until the last few years, and both of my colleagues have focused on it in a good amount of detail today, is the policy side. It's not about what happens after people eat the food, it's how we get the food to the people to begin with, which is really the big problem that we have to think about if we're going to create a sustainable future for the world's children. So the first country I want to talk about is this little sliver of land. Who's ever heard of Malawi? Not many people have. That's where Madonna goes to adopt her children. Malawi is this long country about the size of Pennsylvania, a very small country. And one thing that a lot of people know about Africa is that a lot of it's dry, savanna land, not very difficult to grow food in. And in fact, that is the case for some countries. But if you look at Malawi and trace it down from Egypt where the Nile River begins, Malawi ends with this huge lake, one of the 3 Great Lakes of Africa. Malawi, in fact, is very fertile. It's a big breadbasket. It's capable of producing huge amounts of food, so much so that coffee, tea, and tobacco plantations are hugely profitable in Malawi, and products that get shipped to other countries, including Europe and the United States. So one would wonder, why in Malawi is childhood hunger a problem? Here's a picture from one of the clinics that I worked at for many, many years. And when I first got to Malawi, these are the folks I was introduced to, and completely did not meet the image that I had in my head of the malnourished children I was going to work with, because clearly you look at these children, they're beautiful, they're healthy, great skin, great eyes, healthy teeth, and I'm thinking, all right, who are these children I'm supposed to help survive? And in fact, it can be really misleading. Sure, these children are healthy, because these are the ones that survive their first 4 or 5 years of life. These are the lucky ones. But when you look a little bit deeper, you start seeing a different picture. Back in my hippie days when I had long hair, two of my neighbors, actually, one of the neighbors that I live next to had two children. You can't see them very well. Lovely little children. They were both blind. They suffer from a condition called xerophthalmia. Shortly after their birth, because they were born to a vitamin A deficient mother, the surfaces of their eyes dried out and the oxygen destroyed the surface of their eye, actually melted the corneas, and they lost their sight, both within 6 months of birth. And this is clearly a nutritional issue. It has to do with the lack of one simple vitamin. In fact, what's really upsetting about this particular condition is if you put 2 drops of vitamin A at 100,000 international units into an infant's eye, you can prevent this condition. And that's not a program we had that was sustainable in Malawi because we didn't have those droplets. So in fact, we needed to come up with other solutions. And one of the solutions was, among many, there any sustainable answer to a problem isn't ever a one solution answer. But one of the solutions we came up with was to try to figure out what was lacking in the diet and why there wasn't a lot of vitamin A. And this was actually an easy thing to do in a country like Malawi because there's a traditional diet. Malawians pretty much eat the same thing day in and day out, and believe it or not, they love it. Malawians love traditional food. When you take traditional food away from them, even if they get enough calories, they still feel as though they're missing something. But this traditional food, as you can see on the plate, is very low in vitamin A. Half of the plate's always filled with this big white mass that's called ensema. And ensema is made up of either ground maize. Now, it looks like corn, but it's actually a very starchy form of corn that if you didn't process it by boiling it and grounding it up, you wouldn't be able to eat it. It would be too starchy. Or it's made, for people who live along the lake, from this stuff called cassava, which is a root that grows in sand and actually has natural toxins in it, so you have to soak it. There's a little bit of cyanide, actually, in it. You have to soak it before it's usable. But both of these products are made into that thing called ensema, neither of which have much usable vitamin A for the body. Vitamin A is a fat-soluble vitamin, and it actually is composed of chemicals that create the color in red and yellow and orange vegetables. And it's also very prevalent in dark green leafy vegetables, like pumpkin leaves. And pumpkin leaves are a really common food in Malawi, and you can actually see them represented on the plate as well, usually boiled in oil, and sometimes next to some brown stuff, which is generally beans, but in wealthier communities might be fish or might be meat, also which has some relevant vitamin A in it. But vitamin A as a fat-soluble vitamin is also very unstable. It gets easily destroyed by things like oxygen and light and cooking, heat. Those three things destroy the vitamin A. So while there were some dietary sources of vitamin A, they often got destroyed during the process of cooking the food. So the solution seemed to be trying to get more foods into local folks' diets that had vitamin A in it. But just as Dr. DeNoia talked about before, it's one thing to give a community a solution, it's another for them to adopt it. And we knew that we would not create a sustainable program if we just told people what to eat, even if we gave the food to them. And that's one of the key things to understand. Even if you give something to someone for free, they may not use it, or they may not use it for the long term. So we needed to come up with a different solution. And we used a culturally based solution. We got people who the community respected to sort of adopt these behaviors. And what you see in the picture here are the graduation ceremonies of all of the doctors, all of the nurses, and all of the community health workers who went to a 1-year training about the importance of having variety of fruits and vegetables in one's diet. And what we did for these health workers is we actually helped them set up demonstration gardens at their own homes so that the community could see that the people most valued in their community were buying into this product. And then we set up a demonstration garden at the hospital. I know it's difficult to see, and I'm embarrassed because I don't look like I know what I'm doing, and I really didn't. But we would set these up at the garden, and actual patients would be able to take their food from this program. And it became wildly successful, and I'm actually happy to report 20 years later, the garden is still there. We then took it a step farther, and we started a community orchard, because Malawi is a place where trees grow very, very quickly. You can grow a full papaya tree in 9 months. And papayas have a huge ability to give usable vitamin A, as long as they're not cooked, to a population. So we also created a calendar. You can see it. The whole point of this slide is not my friend Simon here. It's the calendar behind him. We created a calendar using culture as the basis. We think of time linearly. Our calendars are months. Malawians think of time as a cycle, a year as a circle. Half of the year is the dry season, the other half is the rainy season. You can grow some things in the dry season that you can't grow in the rainy season, and vice versa. And many Malawians don't read, so for everything we were encouraging them to grow, we had pictures of the vegetables or fruit rather than words. So these things helped to create a more sustainable solution that was based in nutrition. So the real threat, and I don't know if you caught it, but the word was in one of Dr. Gilley's slides, was that of monoculture. The real threat is a lack of variety. Monoculture means you're growing one thing and one thing only. And there are so many problems with that type of agriculture. We could spend an hour talking about that. But many Malawians grew monocultures, as I talked about. Cassava and maize are very easy to grow. The seeds are very easy and cheap for them to buy. But what happens is the amount of variety in terms of nutrition is reduced in the diet, which can lead to some severe problems for children. In the United States, we have many monocultures that we should be concerned about. We have three major crops of wheat, of corn, and of soybean. There are some real issues that you should continue to learn more about when it comes to just growing one of three crops. So what we need is we need to move toward a place that's looking at more crop diversity. And one of the things that we're trying to do in a lot of the developing areas that we work in is to bring back these things called orphan crops. These are crops and vegetables and fruits that sustain societies for a really long time, but no longer are grown in a wide variety. And the list is much longer than what we have here. But more importantly, it's these crops that are really nutrient dense that can present and prevent those types of nutritional issues that we see in young children. So in the interest of time, I'm not gonna present the second case study, which I think is equally interesting, but I think it's a good chance for us to kind of all get up in the front of the room and talk about this kind of thread of similar issues that, even though we all talked about three different topics, it's sort of like we planned it even though we didn't plan it together. So thank you.
We can certainly see the connections. I think one of the biggest connections is that the community has to be involved, and I think that that means that you guys have to be involved. You're the future of the world, so from a global perspective, it's what you change in your own communities and what you change in a global and a local picture. So let us ask Dr. Gilley, Dr. Kernan, and Dr. Noia to sit in the front, and you all can ask some questions. Is there a mic? There was a mic, but the mic is back there, so please go back there and ask questions.
I have a question for Dr. Tai. What are these collapsing at this particular moment in man's history? Are these collapsing pretty much in industrial societies, in agriculture areas, or are also these collapsing in Asia, in Africa, and Latin America? If they're collapsing in industrial societies, maybe those popular discussions in Times Magazine, et cetera, there may be a kernel of truth in them, in that maybe it's pesticides and insecticides killing off the bees, you know? why are they happening particularly right now? Thank you very much.
Very good questions. Is this on? I can't tell from here. good question. So the basic answer as far as this colony collapse disorder is that it is not just happening in the U.S. or not just industrialized areas, but it does seem to be concentrated in, particularly within the U.S. So it's not a simple answer, but it seems to be that as far as why is it caused, it doesn't seem to be just pesticides, because the patterns, the demographic patterns, don't trace in time or space the incidence of colony collapse disorder. So this is what leads us to think that maybe it has something to do with parasites and pathogens, as far as especially over time, seem to be these new pathogens come up that coincide quite directly with colony collapse disorder. The tracing of the spread of parasites and pathogens is made very difficult by the rapid evolution and mutation and slightly different strains that we need to have very sophisticated tools to identify. But I think overall, I don't think anybody would rule out pesticides as playing a role in it, and that's perhaps why you see the situation be even worse in industrialized places and even worse in countries that tend to use more pesticides than countries that don't, for example, a European versus American comparison. But I think we need to differentiate between the underlying causal factors and the things that are making that worse. I think that's an important distinction to make. And so far, based on my reading of the, you know, experimental evidence, it seems to be that those underlying causes are more based in parasites and pathogens, with things like pesticides and nutritional stress due to monocultures layered on top and making the problem worse.
My question is, when you transport the bees in the trucks to different states, do they, like you say, after the flowers dry out, do you continue to keep them there, let them migrate there, or do you put them back in the truck and transport them somewhere else where they can continue working and making more honey?
The second one of those, yeah. So they pack them up. As soon as the bloom is over, they pack them back up, put them back in the truck. You may have seen that one picture there where often they will leave them on pallets, you know, wooden pallets that forklifts can come and get right under, just like they're transporting, you know, shipping worldwide containers or whatever. So they're easy to move. They just bring the pallet, they pick it up, they put it on the truck, they drive it maybe to another state or wherever the next crop is. They plop it back down. The bees do their stuff, then they move it from place to place. So life as a commercial beekeeper that's involved in pollination you're basically a migrant. You're moving your truck of bees from place to place, renting them out, and there is certainly during the winter in a place like North America, there is a period where not much is growing. Often they'll bring it to Florida. Maybe they can get a little bit of food there because they do tend to grow stuff for a long time in Florida in the winter. But that's what it's like. Does that answer your question? Or?
Is there any chance that the problem, because the way I see it, there's a lot more issues based on what you showed us, but something like global transport is something that you can't take away now in this kind of society that's so dependent on it. And another question was that another thing is that, I mean, in the U.S. it's really more prominent because the U.S. is is very industrialized all around. And my question is there any way to completely eradicate the problem, or do you think the best you can do is probably just minimize it as much as you can?
Oof. it's a great question. It's a big question. I mean, from a sort of scientific point of view, we've got this problem, and so we need to solve it. And so that involves first identifying what's causing it, and then coming up with a, you know, a biological solution in terms of, you know, if it's a bacterium, we're going to come up with a very different solution than if it's a virus or if it's a fungus. That makes a difference in terms of what the solution is. So, you know, that's one aspect of it. But I think there's, again, that distinction that I'm trying to make here between reacting to a problem and trying to prevent future problems. I think that's another important distinction to make. And that's where we get to things like global trade. And, I mean, this has obvious benefits. We're not just going to stop global trade because honeybees are getting too many pathogens, right? So I guess we've got to consider that. This is where it's another great example, I think, of where we get sort of articulation of science and economics and sociology here, where we need to think about what kind of policies we want to make in terms of do we make certain rules that restrict global trade for certain commodities or certain crops or certain, you know, those kind of policies are going to be based directly on what are the real threats that are spreading. You know, is it viruses or bacteria or large macro parasites or whatever? Those answers are going to affect, I think, what kind of policies we make. And so, I mean, there's no easy answer right now, but it's something that we have to think about, I think, as a society, to weigh these costs and benefits and come up with intelligent policies so that we have something that is sustainable. Best answer I can give, I think.
It's right. I mean, the way I see it is not that many problems can be completely eradicated, aside from, problems like pollution and things like that, like big issues. Things like that, but even social things like racism, stuff like that. It's just stuff that you can just minimize. You can't exactly completely eradicate. You know, I mean, is there an area where this problem is more prominent? Like, is it just I know it's the same. It's not exactly the same question. I'm just asking where is it more like prominent in? Is it the U.S. or is it Asia or?
It's more prevalent in the U.S., but it's also you could if you can do a search for do a colony collapse disorder, you know, global map or something like that, and you should be able to find a map of it. But definitely, it is concentrated in the U.S. So and these are all clues. Those are clues that we can use to try and figure out what's going on. But it is a global problem.
You know, I just want to say a few years ago, Target was brought in pine cones. They were bringing them in from Japan. They brought them in for decorative purposes during Christmas holidays. What they didn't realize when they were bringing in the pine cones, which is a commercial, right? They were doing it for commercial reasons so that people could have these pine cones in their houses. They've also introduced a new beetle into the United States that had never been here before that came in with the pine cones. And that beetle went along and destroyed a lot of crops that were being, you know, grown in the United States. And it was for these kinds of things. So those kinds of things we can, on some level, try to control if the government was interested in controlling these kinds of things. You know what I mean? We didn't need those pine cones. We wanted those pine cones. And then the by-result was that we destroyed all these crops with a new beetle that's being introduced. And a lot of new things are being introduced that way, that people are bringing in foreign agents from different countries. And those things are the ones that are like, sometimes, not all together, destroying crops. Arlene?
Yeah, question for Dr. Kernan. I'm thinking about Malawi and the fact that women are responsible for producing most of the food around the globe, the primary producers. So what's being done in Malawi in terms of working with the women to reduce the problem with lack of vitamin A? Are there education programs going on? What else besides, if anything, besides the drops that can be put in the eyes of infants?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I mentioned that there was no one solution to this problem. And so there are lots of programs that we could talk about and policy changes and enforcement, which is sort of what you bring up, Rosa, issues. But specifically with women, some of the successful projects have little to do with what we're talking about today, at least on the surface. In order to increase a woman's ability to make sure she's not vitamin A deficient, it may not, and we learned, is not necessarily about helping her figure out what crops to grow or even getting her access to seeds or farmland. It's more so recognizing that often she's the head of the household, and with the HIV epidemic that has hit Africa very hard in the last 25 to 30 years, recognizing that she may be the only adult being a caretaker for multiple children, is getting that woman situated so that she can generate income. When women can generate income on their own, they can improve their health status across all diseases, chronic and infectious. And that has been shown to be the single biggest determinant of xerophthalmia as a condition among children, is actually preventing it in the mother to begin with, preventing the deficiency in the mother through income generation. So there are lots of microloan projects and small business development projects that help women figure out how to generate income for her household, which in a Malawian society is not just her immediate family. It's everyone in her family, and oftentimes orphans from other families that she's taken in.
If I may add to Arlene's point, but on a macro level, all of you talked about sustainability, I think, you know. That is fine, but the trend in Africa now is corporate investment in terms of food production, displacing the African peasant from his land. GMOs, kind of a green revolution and stuff. What is your opinion on that in terms of food sufficiency for the African people? And what do you think would be the lot of the African peasants removed from his land and so forth?
That's a really important point as well. And that's what I was alluding to when I mentioned that while Malawi is a breadbasket, because 95% of the land could be agricultural land, a good portion of it is still suffering from colonial rule when the British settled Malawi. Upwards of 70% in the 1990s, when I was there, upwards of 70% of the agricultural land was used to grow tea, coffee, and tobacco. Not food for people who lived in Malawi, but products, agricultural products for export. So it's one thing to say that there's enough food or there's enough land, but it's another thing to look at land use issues and who has the right and access to that land. And in fact, Malawi, it's not the village farmer, it's usually big agribusiness, just as we see here in the United States and many other places in the world. Increasingly so, our global food supply is in the hands of a smaller number of people, people who are in it for profit and people who are run by large corporations that are headed by a very small number of people. We should be very troubled by this. At least that's my opinion.
And I have a question that adds to that, because I want to know from Noia, so these are big issues, right? It's not like the individual per se, can impact the corporate big office. So what can I do on a very local level to change what's happening with, vitamin A, bees, and or in specifically like food deserts? It's not like I can change necessarily that there's a food desert in my neighborhood. So what can I do? What responsibility do I have?
I mean, it's interesting. I don't know that that's necessarily true. In the clip of Leah, I didn't show you the second half of it, but in the clip of Leah, she actually went to the mayor of South Central LA and basically advocated and said, we need to do something about this food desert. And as the clip unfolds, you see that they end it with that legislation was in fact passed that banned the establishment of any other fast food restaurants in that food desert. So I didn't mention that in my talk, and I wanted to. I said we need policy initiatives to obviously encourage, to get healthful food sources in, but also to restrict, the proliferation of these less healthful establishments and industries and so forth. I think there's a lot of things that you could do locally, getting out into those communities. Some of those things could be grassroots efforts to try to educate community members. Some of it is really tangible stuff that unfortunately, and this I think was brought up in the clip, was the issue of, in these low-income communities, time, and the students had brought this up, is such a factor, especially if you're working multiple jobs and maybe they're low-wage jobs and you simply don't have the time to go out, to these different venues where you can get healthier stuff. In some of the communities I've worked with, it's people actually going out. I'm thinking actually in our neighboring community of Paterson, where I'm working with a very large WIC agency there, and they on their own have organized to work with farmers markets to bring farmers markets on certain days across the street from this office on the days when the women receive vouchers for food and when they get these farmers market coupons. So to try to think cleverly of how can we meet the needs of our local participants, and one of the ways they're doing that is hoofing it, so to speak, and working with them and helping them set up and encouraging the women on those days to go across the street and use their farmers market vouchers to do some of that stuff. So there's not one answer, I think, and I don't know, Bill, if you have anything to add to that, just different initiatives that I think that we all can play a part in getting out there and trying to be part of the solution.
There's a really famous article that food policy nerds like us alluded to a saying that we have the opportunity to move these policies forward every day because we vote with our shopping carts. So I like to keep that kind of idea in mind. And we vote also for the people who aren't privileged enough to vote for themselves because they can't shop at the sorts of places that we go to.
I want one other question also for Dr. DeNoia. I mean, I keep thinking about the issue of money. And, you know, I know that farmers markets are oftentimes more expensive than other places. And I just wonder, like, how successful, let's say, a farmers market, you know, in an area where people, you know, are, you know, getting food stamps, their incomes are being supplemented, how successful is it to bring a farmer's market? Is that the answer? Is that what, you know, one of the good answers, workable answers?
I mean, my personal opinion is I absolutely think it's a good and workable answer. In this research I've been doing with Paterson and with farmers markets, I'm finding that the issue is very complex, meaning that there are issues on the side of the women, on the shoppers, things like transportation, having small children and having to take buses to get to where the markets are. The question of vouchers that are provided, at least through the food stamp program, are provided in one lump sum. So they're vouchers for $10. In other jurisdictions, they get two of them. In other jurisdictions, they break it out into $4 or $5 units. And in doing focus groups with the women are saying, well, the problem is even when I do get there and I get to the farmer's market, I have to use my whole voucher in one spot. So if I like your peaches, but I like your bananas, I have to get more peaches than I need, and I have to pick who I'm going to buy it from because I don't have the opportunity to break it apart. So there's that issue. And then there's other issues, like in Paterson, there are actually trucks that go to a designated area. Sometimes they don't come every week. Sometimes they unload in a different area, so they're not always consistent in their scheduling of when they get there. So a lot of it for the women is sort of chasing after, you know, where will they be, and when they factor it all in, sometimes they make the decision to forego and to, in fact, buy their produce at the food store as opposed to the farmer's market. It turns out that in Paterson they are more affordable, but it's true that it varies. They're not always more affordable at farmer's markets, but it's the other barriers, notably getting there, things, transportation. And also some of it is lack of familiarity with foods in sort of harvested form and not knowing what some of the items are. So some of it is, again, that nutrition education piece. So it's a big, complex issue, but do I think it's worthwhile, and can it be beneficial? Absolutely. In speaking with some people at the Food and Nutrition Service of the USDA, they've said that their most successful programs are ones where farmers markets are very close to the offices where women get their vouchers and receipts, where they've set them up across the street, so to speak, as a way to kind of make it more convenient and get rid of some of these barriers. But I think a lot more work needs to be done. I don't know. Bill, do you want
to? Yeah, so Paterson Department of Health several years ago received a state grant to build community gardens in conjunction with three of the local schools. It's a large project to try to put a big community-based project like that together, and they ended up not being successful. So different communities have different success with community gardens. Paterson's wasn't successful. They are desperately trying to make it successful. But in other parts of the county, there are actually really successful community garden examples.
All right, I'd like to thank Dr. DeNoia, Dr. Gilley, and Dr. Kernan for their informative presentations today on the global food sustainability issue. The Race and Gender Project thanks you all for being here today. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.